Father, we come to you in the mighty name of Jesus. Lord, we're so grateful as we come into your house that we can lift our hearts, lift our hands. We can lift up the name of Jesus. And Lord, it's in Jesus' name that we come to you tonight. And we would ask that you would open the eyes of our understanding, that we'd be enlightened tonight as we read your word, God, as we hear from your heart and from your spirit. Holy Spirit, you are the true teacher of the church, not me, not a man or a woman, not the young or the old, not the black, the white, the brown, any other color we could imagine, but you. So welcome, Holy Spirit. Be our teacher, be our guide. Give us your vision, your wisdom, your instruction, your direction, even the correction we need for our lives, Lord, and we'll give you the praise and the glory and the honor for it. God, tonight we don't just ask this blessing upon ourselves, but also we would ask it for all the churches, both here in the Inland Empire as well as around the planet, that are both preaching and hearing the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. They're our brothers and sisters, Lord, and at no time do we think of ourselves as any better than anybody else, but we see ourselves as co-laborers and workers together in your field, building your kingdom. So God, we would ask that you bless them as you would bless us tonight. And also, God, we ask that you bless the persecuted church scattered abroad throughout the world, Lord. Watch over them, protect them, deliver them, Lord, from the hand of their enemies. May they endure to the end, to the glory of God. Father, we give you the praise and the glory and the honor. In Jesus' mighty name, we're all in agreement, and we say, amen. Amen. Well, tonight you can get your Bibles and go with me to Galatians, the 5th chapter. And anytime that I'm ministering in one of our evening services, I've been doing a series called Upwards. Tonight we're going to examine another one of the upwards. Galatians, the 5th chapter, we find out that there are works of the flesh and that there are works of the spirit. The works of the flesh are evident. You can see them. You can understand them. You know what they are. If we were to have a list of them, we could list many things that are all downwards. Now, these downwards are things that bring us down in life. They do not get us closer to God. In fact, they will separate us from God. And if we follow them and practice them, they will literally take us down to hell. And so we need to watch what is going on in our lives, and we need to make sure that we are following the will and the way of the Lord. In Galatians chapter 5, verse number 22, talking about not what will take us downwards, but what will lift us upwards, it talks about the fruit of the Spirit. And so here in Galatians chapter 5, verse number 22, it says, but the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, verse 23, gentleness, self-control. Against such there is no law. Now, these are all words that will lift us up. These are upwards, and that as we operate in these things, as we walk in the Spirit, these things will be produced in our lives, and they will lift us up in life. They will lift us up, and we'll become closer to God. Now, love, we said, is the greatest of all of these. That's why it's first in the list. And out of love will flow the rest of these upwards, because God is love, and therefore, love is the supreme power of the universe. As we operate in that love, all of the other upwards will come out of that love that we're operating in. Tonight, I want to take a look at the word long-suffering. Somebody say amen. And the reason why I say that is because when I think about a juicy, yummy, sweet, refreshing, satisfying fruit, I think about love, right? That would be like the greatest one. It has to be huge. It has to be like a jumbo watermelon on a summer's day or something like that. You know what I mean? And then you think about joy. You know, joy has got to be something fun like a banana. You get to peel it. It's yellow. It's fun, right? And then you've got peace. Peace would have to be something soothing. You know what I mean? Like a cucumber. Look it up. It's a fruit, all right? And so anyways, it would have to be something refreshing, maybe a strawberry or something like that in cream on a morning, you know? But then you get to this fruit that if I was to look at them just based on their surface value, I might pass up this fruit called long-suffering. Anybody know what I'm talking about? Because when you look at fruit and you look at satisfaction, you look at taste and sweetness, long-suffering does not sound like sweetness. It sounds more like bitterness, doesn't it? Anything that has to do with suffering, especially in our American society, we would kind of stray away from. And yet, the Spirit of God included this in his list of upwards, things that will take us up as a fruit or a product of the Spirit. And we need to understand what this is. Now, long-suffering could also be translated in some of your translations that you have. It could be translated forbearance, or it could also be translated with a word that we also hate, which is called patience. Am I right, anybody? Patience. Oh my goodness, what are we talking about tonight? We're talking about long suffering. We're talking about patience. I knew I should have stayed home from church. I knew I should have gone to that other church. But listen, patience is not a dirty word. In fact, there are some really neat things about patience. And as we go through the night, you're going to see, not only in the Bible, but also in culture and in different arenas in life, that patience actually, like one person put it, is the queen of all virtues. This is like the crown royal. This is the most beautiful of them all. In fact, I got a couple quotes for you from some people and some different cultures that I thought were kind of fun as we take a look at what we're going to tonight. Benjamin Disraeli, famous British prime minister, said this. He said, patience is a necessary ingredient of genius. That's pretty cool, isn't it? So if you're patient, you might be on genius level tonight. Maybe you didn't realize that, but maybe tonight you're getting encouraged already. How about this? St. Augustine, right? Patience is the companion of wisdom. Well, if you want to be wise, then you should also learn patience. That's kind of cool. How about this? The Chinese have a proverb that says that if you are patient in one day of anger, you will escape 100 days of sorrow. So grasshopper, right? Praise the Lord. How about this? The Dutch have a proverb that says an ounce of patience is worth a pound of brains. I like that one because, you know, sometimes I don't feel like I have that much brains to spare. You know, I've used them all up, but an ounce of patience is worth a pound of brains. Here, last one is this. The Germans have a proverb that says patience is a bitter plant, but it has a sweet fruit. That's interesting, isn't it? Talking about the fruit of the Spirit. See, the original word for long-suffering or patience as we see it is a compound word. It's two words in the Bible. The first one is makros, meaning a long duration or enduring. Okay, that's the first part of this compound word. The second part is thumos, which means anger or passionate swelling emotion. Okay, so you take this long duration, this enduring thing, and you partner that with anger or a large swelling emotion, and you put them together, and it looks like something that doesn't look like patience any longer, does it? Think about that for a second. You've got large emotion, swelling emotion or anger that lasts for a really long time. That does not look like our patience in what we think of when we think of patience in our society. We think of patience as passivity, right? If someone is patient, then they must be just sitting by, content, smiling, making sure there's nothing in their fingernails. You know, they're just kind of passing the time. That nothing bugs them. Nothing gets to them. The kids could be out of control. The boss could be railing at them. The world could be crumbling around them. And there's just sunshine and rainbows and unicorns and all that kind of stuff. And yet, that is not what this word patience is really all about. See, we think of patience as a virtue that we want the people behind us in the car to have and the people ahead of us to desire, right? Because we want to get past them. We want to do our thing. We in our society are always in a rush. And so we think about patience as passivity. And yet, patience is not passivity. Patience is when something happens that there is an emotional response and that there is a swell on the inside of you, swelling emotion, swelling anger. And oftentimes, this is not with stuff. This is with people. Because people can just get on your last nerve. Am I right? Your spouse. Your kids. You don't have to say amen, all right? Because I know some of them are in the room right now. Right? And you were talking about this on the way here. Your boss, your coworkers, your relatives, hello, right? Some of you guys feel like you just barely made it through the holidays. Why? They were trying my patience. See, patience is not passivity, just sitting back and doing nothing. No, patience is when there is a boiling that's coming up on the inside of you and there's some sort of an emotional response and yet it endures for a very long time. It is the ability to take that passion and to have it for a long time. That's why it's long suffering. It's the patient restraint of anger or forbearance is actually a good word for it. See, this long suffering is mentioned of God's patience with men in their fallen state. Think about God for a second. Sometimes we think about God as just kind of like this stone-faced, stoic old man up in the heavenlies who's just kind of sitting back and either doesn't notice the things on the earth or when he notices, he's ready to zap with the lightning bolt. We have those images of God, right? But guess what? God is not Zeus. Hello. God is not Zeus. God is not some angry old miser up in the clouds who's either disengaged with the things on earth or when he is engaged is just violently angry. That is not God. God looks more like we do than we realize because we are made in the image of God. Is that right? The Bible says God was talking to himself, Jesus and the Holy Spirit, right? And he says, let us make man in our own image. That means when I take a look at the heart of the Father, I can see that there are things in humanity that mirror the image of what God is like. Did you know that God made us with emotions? And therefore, that means that God himself has emotions. That means that if God is saying there's long-suffering that I want you to have, and it is a fruit or a product of walking in the Spirit, then God himself has long-suffering. That means that God sees the events on the earth, and it angers him. God is not happy with people going to hell. God is not pleased with the sin on the earth. God is not disengaged. Nothing is outside of his grasp of understanding, and nothing is outside of his notice. God understands all of the hidden motives of the heart, and these things that are unjust actually enrage him. In fact, the Bible says God is storing up wrath for the day of judgment. That ought to scare the hell out of somebody in this place tonight. Because I know it scares the hell out of me. You're saying, I've never heard of a preaching pastor that's cussing. I'm not cussing. Hell is a real place, and all of the things in hell are ungodly, and hopefully it gets the hell out of us when we think about wrath being stored up for the day of judgment. But we see the long-suffering of the Lord in 2 Peter chapter 3 and verse number 9. Turn there with me. If you go towards the back of your Bible, you'll find Hebrews, James, 1st, 2nd Peter. 2 Peter chapter 3. In chapter number 2, Peter starts talking about all of the bad things and lots of bad people and what's going to happen because of that. And he starts to talk about how people are saying, God can't be, you know, real. He can't be really, what's God up to? Everything's been going on since the way it was since the world began. And they don't understand what's going on behind the scenes. And so Peter starts to draw the curtain back and he tells them, listen, guys, God is being patient. Let's take a look at it. 2 Peter chapter number 3 and verse number 9. Look at what it says. The Lord is not slack concerning his promise as some count slackness. Now, what is he saying? He's saying God is not apathetic. God is not reneging on his promise. God is not somebody who is passive. God is not slack concerning his promise as some count slackness. But long suffering. He is that macros and thumia put together. There is anger that has risen up, but it is going on for a really long time. God is enduring the things that are going on the earth. God is long suffering toward us. And when he says us, he's talking about all of us. Not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. In other words, the love of God is so passionate. The love of God is so hot. The love of God is so great that God doesn't want anybody to die and go to hell. And therefore, God is actively, passionately waiting. He is patient. He is suffering long while he waits to see how many are going to come into the fold. While he works things out, while he sends laborers across people's paths, while he waits for people to grow up and to mature so that they can understand what's going on, while people have life experiences that bring them to repentance, where they thought that God wasn't real, where they thought that God was just a fairy tale, that they have an encounter and they come to themselves and they recognize and they realize God is true, God is real, and I need him in my life. God is the father that's pacing and waiting for the prodigal to come home. God is the shepherd that is looking for the lost sheep. God is the one that's searching for that coin. He's the one that's selling all to purchase the field with a pearl of great price. See, God is passionately and patiently waiting for humanity to get it. Because he's not willing that any should perish. He doesn't want people to go to hell. God is not mean-spirited. But at the same time, there is a passion. There is something that's rising on the inside. See, patience and long-suffering don't come from a place of apathy or lack of care. God is passionate about each and every one of us, and those swelling emotions, that great love is what is constraining the wrath of God on the earth. That's what's holding back the hand of God in judgment. See, I like what Rick Renner said about long-suffering in his book, Sparkling Gems from the New Testament Greek. He says, long-suffering is like a candle with a very long wick. It is ready to burn for a very long time. See, if we're going to be long-suffering like Father God in heaven, we need to first of all recognize and realize we're going to be emotional about things. Things are going to bug us. People are going to bug us. You ever read the proverb that says, as iron sharpens iron, so one man sharpens the countenance of his brother, right? You know what happens when iron sharpens iron? Sparks fly, right? There's friction. There's things that are uncomfortable, and there's things that are coming against, and there's things that are causing heat and pressure and all that kind of stuff. See, that's how iron sharpens iron. When you get around other people, see, it's not just going to be the good things that sharpen you. There's also going to be things that God is developing your character through problems and pressures and trials. You will have a response. You will have emotions about things that take place. When you hear that someone else got a promotion ahead of you that you were waiting for, you're going to have an emotional response. It's just going to happen. When you find out that your husband or wife doesn't care as much about the thing that you care about and they write it off, you're going to have an emotional response. When you're out there in the community and you start to witness to people and you're wanting to share with them the love of Jesus and how God saved your soul and they don't give you the time of day, you're gonna have an emotional response. And yet you need to lengthen the wick. You need to add some oil. You need to make sure that you're walking in the Spirit. See, the oil of the Spirit will keep your wick burning a long time. And even though you'll have that anger and that swelling emotion, you'll be able to bear it. You'll be able to suffer through it. Because long-suffering is a product of the Holy Spirit's work of love in us. Remember, we started this when we started talking about the upwards. All of these upwards come out of love. Each and every one of them, you can see how they come out of love. Let me show it to you where it's in bold, plain, black and white print in your Bible. 1 Corinthians, the 13th chapter. Anybody read this yesterday? Come on, 1 Corinthians, the 13th chapter, also known as the love chapter, right? Hopefully some of you guys read this yesterday. Yesterday was Valentine's Day. In case some of you men missed it, you need to go to the store and get some flowers tonight. They'll be on discount since it's the 15th. Buy two sets because you missed it. 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verse number 4. The apostle starts to write under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit what love looks like. And if we're going to walk in love, these are things and characteristics of our love. Notice the very first thing as he defines what love looks like. 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verse number 4. Love suffers long. We don't even have to read the rest of the verse, right? Love suffers long. Long. Now, it goes on to say it's kind, it doesn't envy, it doesn't parade itself, it's not puffed up, right? How about this? Love bears all things, believes all things, endures all things. Sounds a lot like patience, doesn't it? But right out of the gate, we don't even have to go there because love suffers long. That should be the encouragement to all of us that if I'm having a problem with patience, if I'm blowing my top, if I'm like that balloon that just keeps getting inflated and inflated and inflated, one little pinprick will pop me, then guess what? I need to go back to love. I need to operate in love because love suffers long. And if I can walk in the Spirit, if I can walk in this virtue of love, then out of love will come long suffering. See, it should be a revelation to all of us that love suffers. Think about that for a second. We don't think of love as suffering. We think of love as an emotion. We think of love as the butterflies and the pitter-patter and, you know, pink hearts and candy and flowers and all that kind of stuff. But think about this for a second. If God is love and Jesus is God in the flesh, when Jesus was in the flesh, Jesus suffered. Is that right? He was a man of sorrows, acquainted with grief. And therefore, if Jesus is God in the flesh, then Jesus is love incarnate. And therefore, when we see love walking around, talking to people and doing things on the earth, love was a suffering servant. Therefore, if we're going to love like Jesus loved, we're going to have to suffer as well. See, love is not a noun. Love is not a feeling. Love is not the pitter-patters or any of that kind of stuff. Love is not an emotion. Love is an action. Love is a verb. Love is something that when it comes out of us, it will look like something. And that's why the Apostle Paul wrote in 1 Corinthians, the 13th chapter, verse number 4, love suffers long. Why? Because Jesus suffered for a long time. Jesus came and he suffered. Jesus came and he went to the cross. Jesus came and he laid down his life for each and every one of us. Therefore, if you want to know how to have patience, go back to love. Your love will help you to be patient with others. See, Jesus is the expression of the Father, right? Hebrews chapter number 1, he's the image of the invisible God. He's the brightness of his glory. He's the one that showed us the Father. When Philip said, Jesus, just show us the Father, Jesus said, haven't I been with you so long, Philip, you still don't know me? And therefore, if Jesus is the image of God and God is love, then Jesus is the image of love. And our suffering, when it matches the suffering of our Lord Jesus Christ, will be true patience in each and every one of us. I love what Pope Gregory the Great said in the 5th century. He said, true patience is to suffer wrongs done to us by others in an unruffled spirit and without feeling resentment. Patience bears with others because it loves them. To bear with them and yet hate them is not the virtue of patience, but a smokescreen for anger. Now remember, you're going to have anger. You're going to have emotions. There's going to be things that just rub you the wrong way. That's okay. The Bible says, be angry and do not sin. Right? That means that's good news for all of us because it's possible. Hello? Right? Then maybe you never thought of that for a second. Wait a second. So you're telling me I can be angry and not sin? Oh yeah. The Bible says so. You don't have to blow your top. You don't have to punch their lights out. You don't have to knock their teeth in. You don't have to have road rage. Come on, somebody in Southern California, give me an amen on that one. I just was talking to a guy from Indiana. He said, the two things I don't miss about California are the traffic and the DMV. Hello. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. The Bible has a lot to say about our patience with others, about suffering long and not allowing ourselves to get into sin when things come against us, when emotions rise, when stuff happens. 1 Thessalonians chapter number 5, we're going to take a look at one verse, verse number 14. The apostle is giving various instructions at the end of his letter to the Thessalonians. Great things are being said, but look at verse number 14. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 14 says this, now we exhort you, brethren, warn those who are unruly. Some of you guys know some unruly people in this place, right? Encountered them today. Comfort the faint-hearted. Uphold the weak. Now he wraps it all up together. Be patient with all. In other words, while you're warning the unruly, hey, that foolishness is not going to work. You know, some of you employers, you need to talk to the unruly. Right? Some of you parents need to go and talk to the unruly. The natives are getting restless, right? And so you need to go and you need to warn them. Hey, if you keep doing that, keep messing around, we're going to have some discipline, right? But while you're doing that, be patient. Comfort the faint-hearted. When people feel like they're going to lose it and they can't make it and they're starting to lose their grip, it says to comfort them, but also be patient with them. You know, you can get weary yourself with weary people. Is that right? Even Jesus said, how long will I endure? Is that right? See, when things come at you continuously, if people stay unruly, we still need to stay patient with them, even though we're warning them, you better watch out. Hey, there are consequences to what's going on. There are things that are going to take place. But with the faint-hearted as well, sometimes when you see people coming that are always faint-hearted, it's like, oh my gosh, can I just go hide in a corner somewhere? Can I fake like I've got a phone call right now? No, that would be sinful. That's a lie. Okay, so what am I going to do? Maybe I should call my mom. I haven't called her in a while, right? That's not a lie. I'm actually calling my mom. Hey, good to see you. I'm on the phone with my mom. Hey, mom, hold on 1 second. God, don't laugh like you don't do it. That's why you're laughing, right? It's because it's true. But when people only come to you with a problem, they only come to you with the sky is falling, they only come to you with the world is ending, they only come to you with the latest news story, and it's like, hey, put your hope in Jesus. You, after a while, you just want to play a recording, put your hope in Jesus, and you just put it on repeat, right? Shake the playlist. It'll give you the same thing again. You know, whatever it is. But it says be patient in the midst of that. In other words, let the candle burn for a long time. You need to endure that. Why? Because you need to comfort them and uphold the weak. But while you're upholding them, be patient with them. Sometimes we can judge people. We can say, well, they're so weak. Why don't they know this? Why can't they get strong yet? You know, they can be like me. I came out of worse stuff than they did. And yet we don't know the perspective of what's on their life. We don't know what they're going through when they go home. We don't know what has happened to them in their life. And yet the Bible tells us to uphold the weak. And while you're holding them up, be patient with them. See, no matter how people are, if we walk in the power of the Spirit and His love, then we'll be able to be patient with people. We'll be able to suffer a long time. This works for everyone. See, when human nature says, I'm done, have you ever said that? Okay, let's be honest in this place. Have you ever said, I'm just done with that person? I'm done. I am so done. I'm not talking to them anymore. I'm not answering the phone. I'm not going to answer their emails. I'm just done, right? Or how about this one? Maybe some of you guys said, enough is enough, right? We're just done with this. Enough is enough. There's no more, right? I'm not putting up with this any longer. See, when the human nature, when the flesh says we're done, enough is enough, and we're ready to cast someone off, right? You know what the Spirit says? The Spirit says you can go longer. Yeah. Well, God, how long does it take? And the response of the Spirit would be, until. How long did God wait for you and for me to quit being foolish? We should at least give other people that amount of time to get their heads on straight. You still love me? I still love you. Let me show you how this works, because right now it's unattainable. Everybody's going, I don't know how to do that. I guess I'm just going to have to sit passively by and not do anything and just be frustrated. No, that's not the case. Because long-suffering grows as our love grows. You want to know how to be long-suffering with stupid people? You do, don't you? You do. You want to know how to be long-suffering with people who are obstinate, unruly, the foolish? You want to know how to be long-suffering with people who don't get it over and over, and I've told them several times, we've had the meeting, and we've had the slip, and we had this and that. You want to know how to do it? Love them. Because long-suffering grows as our love grows. If you're having trouble with your spouse, love for your spouse will endure and stay with them through problems in marriage. You can endure the trial if you operate in love in your marriage. If you're frustrated beyond frustrated with whatever it is that they're doing, and most of the time it's the men, well, I'll say that for us, okay, right? And the ladies, you got some stuff too, okay, so don't say too big of an amen right now. But we'll take the brunt because we're the leaders in the home. And if we would get our stuff straight, then you all would get your stuff straight. We can acknowledge that, okay? Because we're man enough to admit it. It's a man's church, let me tell you that right now. Because you won't hear this stuff in other places. We're man enough to get in your face and tell you the truth. Men, we are responsible for what goes on in our homes. And therefore, as the head of the house, as the leaders, if we would get our stuff together, everybody else would get their stuff together. That's how it works. If the leader and the head is doing his job, then the body and the rest will do their job. Okay, so we'll take that responsibility. But if the husband is not doing his job, wife, love him. Submit to him as unto the Lord, that he without a word may see your conduct and find the word through you. See, your love for him will bring him around. Your love for him and your love for the word of God, love never fails. That's what the Bible says. And it will allow you to suffer long. Men, if the wife is not doing what she should be doing, love her to life. Love her. Go back. Why did you marry the girl? Because I loved her, right? Go back to that place. If you're suffering in your marriage, and if you're saying, man, I got all this anger, I've got all this emotion, I don't know how to lengthen the wick. Here's how you do it, through love. Love for your children. Some of you guys, your children, you just don't even like them. Oh, you love them, but you do not like them, right? Listen, I get it. There have been times where I would have said, I could do without that one, right? And at different points, it's been each of them, you know. So in case they're listening later on in life and they're wondering why Dad, you know, said that about them, it's not just them. There's moments. We all have moments, right? But you know how you can endure the two-year-old tantrums and the tween years and the teenage angst and all that kind of stuff? Love. If you can love them, if you can just have compassion on them and say, Lord, I know they're stupid. I know that their brains are still developing. And as teenagers, they've migrated south for a season. But God, I'm going to love them through that because someone loved me through that, right? They didn't murder me on the way up. They might have tried, but they didn't succeed. Thanks, Mom and Dad. Love them. See, love will overlook foolishness and failures. Love will work with that child as they learn and as they get it, as they stumble and scrape their knee and cry. And you already told them that was going to happen when they come crawling back with tears in their eyes, saying, I know you told me. There's that shame, that thing that hovers over them. Love will embrace them and pray for them and lift them up, cause them to become great and mighty men and women of God. They have a future. They have a hope. See, love for the people of God. If you have problems with, in church with people, you know, that's one of the number one things that bounces people out of good ministries is you know what, I love the preaching. I love the environment. I love the praise and worship. I love the music. I love the facility. Everything's great. But you know what? I just can't stand the people. You know, they're mean to me when I walk in. The usher said something nasty to me, you know, and they just didn't like the way that somebody did something or the greeter didn't smile as they thought that they should smile. You know, I know that never happens in Dennis's door, but somebody else's door, you know. Somebody didn't smile the right way. They didn't shake their hand that day. They were wiping their sweat or something like that, and they just missed somebody on the way in, and they get offended. You know how you can suffer along with people in church? Love them. Love them. Listen, we are all on a journey going up. None of us has arrived yet. We are all learning how to walk on the highway of holiness. If the pastor offends you or the people offend you, love will overcome that. You know, the Bible says love covers the multitude of sins. That's an amazing thought when you think about it. That means that we can endure all things. How can we do that? Through the power of love. If you love the brotherhood, if you love the people of God, then love will help you to forgive and move past the offense. It just won't, just like water on a duck's back. It'll just come right off you. Love for the lost. Sometimes we get so frustrated with lost people. All they want to do is argue. I try and tell them about Jesus, and they start talking about Noah and the ark. I don't want to talk about Noah and the ark. I want to talk about Jesus. And they keep going back to creation and science and all this stuff, and I'm done, right? Enough is enough. No, love them. They're headed for hell. God is waiting patiently for them. He's been waiting all this time. He's been setting all this stuff up, and he put you in their life, and they irritate you. But if you can let the wick out, if you can let love go, that love, that wick, will be a rope that's a lifeline to somebody that's fallen into hell. And they'll be able to grab a hold of that love. They may not understand science. They may not understand creation. They may not understand your logic and your reasoning, but they will feel your love as you suffer along with them and overlook their foolishness. That's how you can be patient with stupid people. Hello. Let love lead and patience will follow. Let love lead and long suffering will come out of you. See, remember, this is a product. This is a fruit of walking in the Spirit. And all of these fruit that we see, in fact, when you think about it, it doesn't say fruits of the Spirit. It's not talking plural. It's fruit. It's singular. The fruit of the Spirit is love. See, this is all wrapped up together. This is all a product. This is all one thing when it looks like it's coming out of you from the heart of God. A tree doesn't bear various types of fruit. It bears fruit, right? One type. Oranges come out of an orange tree. Lemons come out of a lemon tree. Apples come out of an apple tree. But if you notice, God patiently waits for the apples to come out, and he does it without a lot of noise. Hello? See, that's what patience looks like. See how patiently the farmer waits for the precious fruit of the ground to come forth. See, we need to understand these. We don't understand these things in American society. We say 30 minutes or less or it's free, right? You know what that's from? That's from a Domino's commercial in the 80s, guys. We have moved past that in life. But as a society, we're linked up with that. And I think it's spilled over and everything's on demand now. Everything, you push a button on a phone and you get a song or a movie or you get instant access or you get a passport or travel. You get whatever you want all by pushing a button. And we're saying, God, I don't want problems in life. God, I don't want to have problems with I want to have a perfect marriage. I want to have perfect kids. And how come the button's not working? And God's saying there isn't a button. There's a seed that's sown of love and you have to wait. We have a choice. We can either let love lead and patience will follow, or we can fall apart on the ground and kick and scream. Leonardo da Vinci said this. I love this. You guys like the quotes tonight? Like I said, tonight we got all sorts of things. Listen to what Leonardo da Vinci says. I love this. It's brilliant. He says, patience serves as protection against wrongs, as clothes do against cold. Think about this for a second. A little chilly on your way in. What did you do? You layered up, right? So he says, patience serves as a protection against wrongs, as clothes do against cold. For if you put on more clothes as the cold increases, it will have no power to hurt you. So in like manner, you must grow in patience when you meet with great wrongs, and they will then be powerless to vex your mind. Is that amazing? Do you know he's just repeating a principle that's in the Bible? You want me to show it to you? Yeah. Let's take a look at it. Colossians chapter 3. Colossians chapter number 3. Let's take a look at this principle in the Bible. Okay? Because what Leonardo da Vinci said is brilliant, but it is a principle that you will find in the Bible. Galatians, Ephesians, Philippians, Colossians chapter number 3. Colossians chapter 3, we're going to read three verses, verse 12, 13, and 14. Look at what it says, Colossians chapter 3, verse number 12. Therefore, as the elect of God, holy and beloved, put on, everybody say put on. There's a layer, right? Look at what he says, put on tender mercies, kindness, humility, meekness, long suffering. You got to put it on. Why? Because out there in the world it's cold. And it's getting colder as the days grow darker. And so you're going to need an extra big, thick base layer called long suffering. Not your long johns, your long suffering. Hello. See, Leonardo da Vinci, he may not have known it, but this is a biblical principle. Look at what it says, verse 13. Bearing with one another and forgiving one another. If anyone has a complaint against another, knock him in the teeth. Is that what your Bible says? No. What does he say? He says, if anyone has a complaint against another, even as Christ forgave you, so also you must do. Once again, Jesus Christ is our example. Jesus Christ died for us while we were still sinners. In fact, we're 2,000 years after Jesus Christ died. Is that right? He died for us knowing that we were going to sin and mess up. And then when we gave our hearts to the Lord, he received us into his family knowing that we would mess up after we got saved. Talk about patience. Talk about long suffering. Talk about love. Mm. Jesus wipes away all of our transgressions. He blots out the entire amount of the weight of sin and the code that was written against us. There was a record of our sin that was written. He blotted it all out with his blood. Cast it as far as the east is from the west. You know, on the earth, you can find the North Pole and the South Pole, but there is no East Pole and West Pole. It just goes on forever and ever and ever and ever and ever. That's how far God has cast your sin from you. Wow. Wow. Look at the next verse. Verse number 14. But above all, everybody say above all. Above all these things, put on, everybody say put on, love, which is the bond of perfection. Many people want to be perfect. Many people want to be complete. We want to be completely outfitted and ready for life. And God says love is what holds it all together. I think about it this way. If you're going out in a snowstorm, what's the one thing you don't want to forget? Your jacket, right? You don't want to forget your jacket. Because you could wear pants, you could wear your belt, you could wear shoes and socks, you could wear a shirt, you could wear a hat, but if you go out there without your jacket, you're going to be cold, right? So he says, above all these things, get your base layer on, get your long John song suffering on, get your shirt, your meekness, get your pants, right? Get that forgiveness. You got to walk in that, so get your shoes on, right? And he says, but above all these, don't forget your jacket if you're going out to play in the snow, because it's cold out there. And if you layer up, that cold will have no effect on your life. Even though there may be swelling anger, it might be hot inside that jacket, right? Even though the cold will never touch you, you will be able to endure. And as you operate in this patience, this long suffering, it will lift your life. It will not drag you down. It will lift you up. Longsuffering is an upward. Can somebody say amen? Tonight, let's just take a moment and let's pray. Let's take a moment, let's bow our heads, let's close our eyes. And I want you to think about this. What is God speaking to you? What's God ministering to your heart tonight? Are you at odds with someone? Is there bitterness and unforgiveness? Maybe you blew your top. What's God speaking to you? Maybe you were done. You said, enough's enough. Can't do this anymore. And you stopped loving. What's God speaking to you? Just listen for the voice of the Lord right now. Let him minister to your heart. Listen for his whisper. For some of you, God said, put on love. Put it on. You took it off. It's time to pick it back up. It's time to put it back on. To some in this room, God is saying, forgive. Release the offense. As long as you hold on to it, it's going to hurt you. It's not hurting them. It's hurting you. It's time to let it go. Right now, just by faith, let it go. Tell the Lord, I forgive them, and I release it to the blood of Jesus. Just as I've been forgiven, I forgive them right now. Some of you guys, God's saying, you need to endure. You need to hold on a little longer. Some of you, God said, you got to hold on a lot longer. Get ready for the long haul. You're going to need an extra thick coat because you're going to be out there a while before you see the results. It's okay. As you walk in the Spirit, God will give you the power to do what you need to do. What's God speaking to you? Would you just take a moment and write that down? Would you just, if you have a notebook or a pen or anything like that, maybe you want to jot it down on the leaf of your Bible. Maybe you got your cell phone you're taking notes on tonight or your tablet. Just take a moment, write it down. What you're doing is you're committing that. I forget the stuff that I don't write down. So if God spoke something to you, would you just take a moment and write that down? If you're here with your husband or wife, would you just whisper that in their ears? Just tell them what God spoke to you right now. There's accountability when you speak it. And right now in the house of God, while you've got the presence of God, and this is the moment of courage, this is the moment to say it. Maybe you need to say, I'm sorry, please forgive me. Maybe you need to say, I forgive you. It's okay, go ahead and whisper that. Maybe you're here with a friend tonight and you just want to be accountable and you'd like to share that with your friend next to you. Go ahead right now. Just maybe show them what you wrote. This is what God spoke to me and I want to be accountable to this. Maybe you're here with a coworker. There's someone at work that's been bugging you and you need some help. You need an accountability partner to give you the symbol, you know. Don't do that. Don't go there. Father, we thank you for your word tonight, God. And Lord, we pray that as we walk in love, God, that you would pull out of us all these fruit of the Spirit. Lord, specifically tonight, help us to be patient with others. Help us to be patient with the lost and have the love of God for those that are perishing. Help us to be patient with one another as the brotherhood, God. As brothers and sisters in the Lord, may we allow love to cover the multitude of sins, God. May we walk in forgiveness and love. Oh, Lord, with our spouses, with our children, God, with the people we work with and the people in the community, people out there in the world we don't even know. Sometimes we can't even be patient with people we don't even know, God. People on the road, people on television, God, people that we don't understand their ways, God. We release that to you right now. Help us to lengthen the wick with love, God. Being prepared to burn for a long time. Even though we're going to have emotions, even though things are going to rise up on the inside of us, Lord, we commit to be patient and long-suffering by the power of your Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name, everyone in agreement said, amen. Can we just give the Lord a praise tonight? Hallelujah. That's good. Hey, tonight you guys have been wonderful. Thank you guys for staying put. Appreciate you guys doing that. I just want to talk to you about one more thing before we leave this place tonight. I don't know everybody in the room. You know, we had some guests come for the first time tonight. And I just want to talk to you for a moment. In fact, the Spirit of God is still speaking, still ministering tonight. And I want you to just focus in on what God's saying. Tune out all distractions. If the ushers are still doing their job, that's okay. Let them do their job. Don't think about anybody else at this time, what's going on, what people are doing, anything like that. I want you to just focus in. A couple minutes, and then we'll let you go tonight. I want to talk to you about your eternal life. The Bible says it's appointed for man to die once and then to the judgment. not coming back as a frog or a dog. You don't get second chances after you die. Your opportunities are right here and right now. And tonight, I want to talk to you about your eternal life. What if tonight was your last night on the earth? Where would you end up? Because the Bible tells us we're only going to go one of two places. You're either going to go to heaven or you're going to go to hell. It's a very real place. You know, sometimes people say, I don't believe in hell. Well, that's convenient to say, but it's not reality. Because hell is a very real place. And just by denying its existence doesn't make it go away. You're going to have to face the reality of it. It's not a fairy tale parents made up to scare their children into being good. It's not a religious thing. This is a real thing. It's a real place. Jesus himself spoke of it. And I want to make sure you don't go there. In fact, I know you want to make sure you don't go there, right? Probably part of the reason why you came to church tonight. You're seeking God. But listen, just like we heard tonight, God is long-suffering. God doesn't want you to go there more than you or I don't want you to go there. So tonight, let's listen up. Let's talk about your eternal life. Somebody in this place said, well, Pastor, you know, I'm going to go to heaven because all roads lead to heaven. Well, again, that's convenient to say, but it's not reality. That's like me saying all roads lead to the moon. You could drive around the earth as long as you want. You'll never make it. So in the same way, what makes us think we can do whatever we want to do and we'll make it to heaven? Don't you think God, the creator of the heavens and the earth, the one who wrote the plan of redemption, carried it out in his son, Jesus, don't you think that after he does all that he would tell us how to get to heaven? Well, he does right here in his word. Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, and life. No man goes to the Father except by me. That means it's God's heaven. We got to get there God's way. So I mean, this place said, well, Pastor, okay, I get that. And I know God lets good people into heaven. I've been pretty good. Used to be bad, clean up my act. Now I'm good. I think my good finally outweighs my bad. Got involved in social justice causes. Been nice to my neighbor. Give my money to charities. And I think that I've been good enough. But the problem with that is, how good do you have to be good enough? Could you show that to me in the Bible? Is there like a scale or a line that you have to be above and behind the maps? Is there a place where God says, be this good or do this many good deeds and then I'll let you into heaven? It's not there. Nowhere in the Bible does it say, just be good and that'll get you into heaven. You know what the Bible does say? The Bible does say, all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. No one is perfect except one. His name is Jesus. The Bible does say our good works compared to God's goodness like filthy rags. You're not going to make it to heaven based on just being good. Sometimes people say, well, Pastor, okay, I get that, but I was raised in church. Parents told me you were Christians growing up. Hung a cross or St. Christopher on your neck. Had you baptized your Christian as a child? You wore religious jewelry, you know, cross or St. Christopher, that sort of thing. Maybe you wore a t-shirt that said Jesus. Attended religious classes like Sunday school or Sabbath school, maybe catechism class. And you've always thought of yourself to be a Christian. Born in America. America's a Christian nation. Everybody born in America is going to heaven, right? Wrong. Did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say just be raised in church, parents tell you Christian, that makes you a Christian? It doesn't work like that. You say, Pastor, okay, I get that, but you know, not only when I was a child did I go to church, here I am sitting in church right now. Doesn't that mean that I'm a Christian? Well, no, that's like me saying, you know what, I really want to be a fish. I've always admired fish. I really would love to be able to swim underwater. You know, I always enjoyed the ocean. I think I'll just go to the ocean, sit in the water, call myself a fish, and that makes me a fish. No, regardless of what our society might say, I will never become a fish, right? I'll never be able to go under the water and create gills for myself and stay under there and grow fins and all that kind of stuff. I'm just going to be a dude sitting in the water calling himself a fish, but really a human. So you can't just sit in church, call yourself a Christian, and abracadabra, poof, that makes you a Christian. It doesn't work like that. Sometimes people think, well, okay, I get that, but my last church I got involved, I helped out, sang in the choir, carried the pastor's Bible, made decisions in that church. People thought of me as a leader. Even got a membership card to that church. That's great. I'm glad you did those things. Show that to me in the Bible. Your volunteerism gets you into heaven. It doesn't work like that. God is not looking for your membership card to a church before you enter the gates of heaven. And if that's how you think you're going to get there, you're not going to make it. Let me love you enough, respect you enough, and honor you enough tonight to tell you the truth. Sometimes people think, well, Pastor, okay, but hold on a second. I know God. I mean, I know about Jesus. I celebrate Easter and the resurrection. I sing the songs of Christmas every year of my life. I could quote scriptures to you, Pastor. And while that's great, I'm glad you can do those things, just show that to me in the Bible where that gets you saved, having head knowledge about who Jesus is. Do you know that if you read your Bible, the devil knows who Jesus is and can quote scriptures out of his mouth? He's not a Christian. The demons believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. They're not Christians. So everybody, look up here at me for a second. This is not about what you have in your head. Not about having mental assent towards God, knowing who Jesus is, and that gets you right with God. But rather, this is about your heart. God's always been after your heart. Remember, we're doing this God's way. Jesus said, if you want to enter the kingdom of heaven, he said these words, you must be born again. John, the third chapter. That's God's way. You must be born again. Now, sometimes we turn off at this point. Ooh, born again, I didn't know you were that kind of church, right? Crazy stuff. I've seen that in movies, television, Hollywood books, read about it on a blog on the internet, right? Listen, let's not let some guy in his underwear in the middle of the night define for us what being born again means, right? Anybody on the internet can define something for us. Who is that person anyways? Let's not let the world or Hollywood or a movie tell us what being born again is. Let the Bible tell us about what being born again is. Because you're not going to get there any other way. Jesus said you must be born again. That means if you're not, you're not going to make it. Tonight, I love you enough to tell you the truth. You're not going to make it. So what does being born again really mean from the Bible? Well, from the beginning of the Bible to the end of the Bible, it's always meant the same thing. It means that you've given God all of your heart and that you've given God all of your life. It's just that simple. It's all or nothing with Jesus. Let me prove it to you. Last book of the Bible, book of Revelation. Jesus is speaking to a church just like he's speaking to us here in this church tonight. And he says, when I come, I want to find you hot or I want to find you cold, because if I find you lukewarm, I will vomit you from my mouth. Now, lukewarm, what's that all about? Well, it's a little in, little out, little up, little down, little token prayer every now and again, and occasional church attendance. God is something in your life, but he's not everything. You're not opposed to God, but you're not wholehearted for God. Listen, if that's your relationship with Jesus, not going to make it. How do I know that? Because only people that are not real Christians will be ejected and rejected for the body of Christ. So tonight, your call. Tonight, your choice. In a moment, I'm going to have everybody bow their heads and close their eyes, okay? I'm going to let you know what we're going to do up front so you don't think I'm trying to trick you or anything like that. Everything's up front tonight. I'm going to have everybody in the room in a moment bow their heads and close their eyes. As you do that, I'm going to go back to that question. If you were to die tonight, where would you go? Some of you are going to answer. You're going to say, well, I think, I hope, maybe I'd go. I don't know. Some of you are going to say, I know I wouldn't go. Listen, if you answered that question in any of those ways, that tells you where you're at with God and that you need to get right with God tonight. And then in that moment, with your heads bowed and your eyes closed, I'm going to count to three. One, two, three, and I'll pop my hands together. Bang, just like that. When you hear the sound of my hands popping together just like that, bang, that's your opportunity to raise your hand. What you're doing by the raising of your hand is you're saying, I want to be born again. I want to be headed for heaven, denying my presence in hell. Why do we do it that way? Because Jesus said, if you confess me before men, I'm a man, I'll see your hand go up. He says, I will confess you before my Father who is in heaven. But he also says, if you deny me, I will deny you. So tonight, it's your call. Tonight, it's your choice. And then right after that, remember, I'm telling you everything that's going to happen up front. We're going to pray together a simple prayer to invite Jesus in your heart. We'll gather together and we'll pray. It's that easy. It's that simple tonight. Okay? So let's do this. Everybody, please bow your heads. Everybody, please close your eyes during this time. And I want you to focus your heart, focus your mind on this question and really examine where you're at with God tonight. What if tonight was your last night on the earth? Would you go to heaven or would you go to hell? Just answer that question in your heart. No one will know the answer but you and God. Would you go to heaven or would you go to hell? If you said, I think, hope, maybe, I don't know, or I know I wouldn't go, tonight is your night of salvation. This is not the time to get up and leave. I'm going to ask everybody to remain seated. Okay? The devil's trying to knock you out right now. Don't get distracted. Focus in. Where would you go, heaven or hell? I'm going to pop my hands together and then we're going to pray together. If you want to be included in that prayer, get ready to get your hands up. Here we go. One, two, three. Let me see your hands if that's you. You need to give God all of your heart. You need to give God all of your life. Just raise it up high for me right now. There's one. There's two. God bless you. Who else today? There's two. There's three. Got you over here. Who else? Who else? There's three wise people already. Anybody else real quick? Need to give God all of your heart. You need to give God all of your life. Just to answer that question and then respond. Don't wait. Don't hesitate. If your heart's pumping out of your chest right now, listen, the Lord's tugging at your heart. And you need to respond. Don't resist the Holy Spirit right now. Who else today? Thank you. Thank you over there. Got you. God bless you. Who else tonight? Anybody else that I didn't already see? Get it up high for me right now if that's you. Anybody else? Come on. Got you right here. Thank you. God bless you. Anybody else? Anybody else real quick? If you haven't already raised your hand, this is the last call. I'm going to do one more sweep through and this is your time. This is your moment of salvation. If you're sitting there wondering if you should do this, yeah, you should. God's speaking to you right now. Come on, listen to his whisper. Anybody else real quick? Anybody else? Anybody else? Just raise it up high. I want to include you in that prayer tonight. If that's you, just get your hand up right now. Anybody else? All right, let's give the Lord a great big praise tonight. Let's all stand. And again, this is not the time to leave. We're going to gather together and we're going to pray for those of you that raised your hand, or if you should have raised your hand but you didn't. Get a hold of your coat, purse, sweater, Bible, a friend if you need a friend. Once you get in the aisle and meet me up front, we're going to pray together tonight. We can't do that till we get you down here. So let's all welcome them. If you raised your hand or you should have raised your hand, you come right now. Come on down to the front.
Oh, come to the altar.
Come on, they're coming. Let's give them a hand as they come. You can come too.
Our open wide forgiveness was bought with the precious
they're coming.
Of Jesus Christ. Oh, come.
Even if you didn't raise your hand, you can come right now. Come on, just make your way to the front.
The Father's
they're still coming. Come on, you can come too.
Forgiveness was bought with.
Nudge your neighbor. Say, friend, I'll go with you if you need to go. Come on, just nudge him right now. Come on, friend, I'll go with you. Come on. Come on, if you need someone to come with you, they're coming. They're coming. You can come too right now. This is your time. This is your moment. Come on. All right, hey, everybody up front. Thank God you guys have come. Came to give God all of your heart. Came to give God all of your life. This is the best decision of your life right here. Right now, I'm going to lead you in that prayer just like we talked about. This is about your heart going before the Lord, okay? Not about the words of your mouth. This is a spiritual thing, okay? So if you mess up on a couple of the words, that's okay. This is really about what's going on the inside right now, okay? Prayer is simply talking to God. So let's focus on the Lord. Let's do that by bowing our heads. Let's close our eyes. Everybody's going to join in with you and say these words. Say, Father God, I come to you now in Jesus' name. I give you all of my heart and all my life. Come into my heart. Be my Lord and my Savior. Forgive me my sin. Wash me with your blood. Cleanse me of my past. And fill me with your Holy Spirit. Give me a brand new future with you. I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. That he came, that he died, and he's raised again to life. Just for me. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. Come on, let's give the Lord a great big praise tonight. All right. Now, everybody up front, we want to get some stuff in your hands. Free information. Find out what to do next in your walk with God. I'll link you up with someone here in the church who will help you to get strong. It's easy. It's free. Okay? And right over here is my friend, Pastor Joel, waving at you. Really good guy. Nothing weird goes on. Okay? You already got past me. I'm about as weird as you're going to get tonight. Okay? He's cool. He's going to give you that information, talk to you about a program. Take a couple minutes, and then he'll let you come right back out. Your friends and family will wait for you. If you guys just make a left turn, follow Pastor Joel right this way. Let's give him a hand as they go. Hallelujah.